So last time I think I got through everything and then I had to stop at the point of anesthesia, yeah? Does that sound right? All right, I'm gonna try to get through everything in this handout today up to like the first page of the Parkinson's. So it's pretty much everything except the last page of Parkinson's is my what I wanna get through because it's the stuff that's on the test. So. Now, general anesthesia used to be a two-hour lecture that I used to give, but I realized that a lot of you are not going into anesthesia, and so what was most important was to give you the information that you would need to take care of post-surgical patients on the in hospital floors, at least in the beginning of your training. So I tried to really pare it down to like the most common ones that you'd see, because anesthesia has a lot of consequences and in terms of the way the patient recovers, and everybody recovers differently, and anesthesia is always a risk, pretty much always is a risk. All right, it used to be that when people used to anesthetize people with ether or booze, there'd be these stages of anesthesia. And I remember it from when I was in medical school, that when a patient was being put under, first they would start acting goofy and kind of drunk and saying hilarious things, and then they would sort of fall asleep. Today, because of the inducing agents we have that are so like propofol, you tell a patient to count backwards from 100 and it's like this. They say 190, it's like that. It's incredibly quick. So you don't really see those stages unless they're coming out of the anesthesia. Stage three, or the stage of surgical anesthesia, is the one where you put somebody completely out and generally you've inhibited their medulla oblongata sufficiently so that they're no longer breathing on their own. Another thing you can do to have them not breathe is to give them a paralyzing agent. And that's extremely common because you give a paralyzing agent to a patient with general anesthesia so that they don't fight the ventilator because you want to have control over their airway. Now, if you give them too much anesthesia, you get to the point of stage four, stage of medullary depression, which is sort of like almost pretty much being dead, which is not good. So you don't want their heart to stop. The stage of surgical anesthesia amongst nurse anesthetists have many, 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 many levels, and the goal is to keep the patient as close to just being asleep as possible and as far away from being dead as possible in that range. Now, there's no one drug that works for all of the things you need for general anesthesia, which is you need to make them unconscious, you need to make a hypnotic, or you make them asleep, you need to control pain, and you need to paralyze them so you can use the ventilator. So you have to use three different drugs for that, and it occasionally happens that the person is paralyzed, but they are still feeling pain and they are still awake, but they can't respond. So every now and then you'll see in the news an article about somebody who says, I could feel the whole thing, which you can imagine would be very unpleasant, and I could hear everything, and they prove their point by repeating what they heard during the case. That's why the nurse anesthetist and the anesthesiologist get paid the big bucks, because they have to be able to tell if a person is awake even when they're paralyzed, which is not a simple thing. It takes a lot of training and experience. So that's the stages of general anesthesia. So let's just talk about a couple of drugs that are used. The kind that are inhaled, generally speaking, are the halogenated hydrocarbons. The halogenated hydrocarbons are inhaled and are distributed to the body by being absorbed through the lungs. They are metabolized and excreted in the kidney. It's not like you just breathe it off, although you do breathe some of it off. But it's the method of administration is inhalation. The thing to know about the halogenated hydrocarbons is that there is a thing called malignant hyperthermia, where the patient suddenly starts getting very hot. And the etiology of this seems to be that the muscles, you remember how when you study muscles, there was actin and myosin, right? And then there's like the myosin head, it looked like a golf club, and it would like ratchet along the actin and close. So the problem in malignant hyperthermia is that the actin and myosin are stuck together and can't disengage, but they're still trying to contract, so that generates heat. So patient's whole body gets very hot. And this seems to occur most frequently in when you combine a halogenated hydrocarbon. I just really like saying that phrase, halogenated hydrocarbon. It's like medulla oblongata. Halogenated hydrocarbon combined with succinylcholine. So succinylcholine sounds like acetylcholine, right? So succinylcholine is actually two acetylcholine molecules that are chemically bound. And what happens is they bind the acetylcholine nicotinic muscular receptor, the one at the neuromuscular junction, And when they bind there, they like stimulate that receptor too much. And what happens is the muscles of your body contract and then just go limp. So it's called a depolarizing paralyzing agent because it depolarizes the muscle too much and then And so patients sometimes after surgery will complain, and you know, you're the ones taking care of them afterwards, they're gonna complain, oh, I have muscle cramps. Like, why do I have muscle cramps? Well, it's because your whole body went. So sometimes they have pain from that contraction. When you combine the halogenated hydrocarbons with succinylcholine, you can get this malignant hyperthermia. That can happen during procedures, and anesthesiologists I know, pretty much all of them said they have seen it, you know, once or twice. But it can also happen up to 24 hours later. So if you have a patient who had surgery at 7 in the morning, and now it's 2 in the morning, and there's nobody around, and the patient has malignant hyperthermia, you have to catch it, because otherwise they will die. So that's something you need to stay alert for. And there's lots of reasons people have high temperatures after surgery. One is that anesthesia screws up your hypothalamus a little bit, so your temperature regulation is a little messy, so sometimes people will have a little fever after the procedure. Or maybe, you know, somebody coughed up something and landed in the patient's chest cavity or something. Or, you know, you left a sponge. They can have an infection. But the malignant hyperthermia, the temperature gets higher, very fast. They also get muscle contractions. And once your temperature is above like 106, 107, you start to cook your brain. That's no good. Yes?
I was just going to ask if it's like a noticeably higher.
Yeah. It's like a rapid And also the patient has symptoms that are. So the treatment for that is another muscle relaxant called dantrolene. Dantrolene works by unhooking the actin and myosin. So, malignant hyperthermia, it doesn't happen often, but if you don't catch it, your patient's going to croak, you will feel terrible, and you'll probably get sued. So let's not do that. Something to be aware of. Isoflurane, as far as I can tell, is the most commonly used one nowadays. And the only thing is that it increases intracranial pressure, so you can't use it in head trauma cases. So isoflurane starts with an I, and it increases intracranial pressure. That's how I remember it, has all eyes. So that's that. Okay, so that's something that puts you to sleep. Then we have ketamine. Ketamine is a drug which evidently is used on the streets, and it's called either Special K or Molly. I don't know, that's what I read. And ketamine is a very short-acting drug. It makes you anesthetized. In adults, up to 10 or 15% of adults, when they're waking up from ketamine, they have horrible hallucinations and visions, and it's awful. There's been some work recently showing that if you wake up the patient in a quiet, calm environment, that the chances of them having this horrible reaction are reduced. So if you ever end up working in a post, you know, a surgical recovery unit, you go in, it should be quiet anyway, but if someone's using ketamine, you want it to be very quiet. Ketamine causes this dissociative anesthetic state. So last week I showed you the little kid who had ketamine, right? And then he looked really bad, like he looked like he was dead, his eyes were open and just looked scary. That's a dissociative anesthetic state. The patients don't remember anything, but they are not aware of what's going on around them. All right. And I mentioned here weirdly that patients, I think I said this last time too, the dextromethorphan or DM, which is in a lot of cough syrups, its chemical family is an opiate, and evidently teenagers like to do robo-tripping, where they drink a lot of Robitussin, or two or three bottles of it, I guess, which is gross, because they think they're going to get high like heroin. But usually what happens is there's cross-reaction with these NMDA receptors, and so they actually go into dissociative anesthetic state before they stop breathing, which is, I mean, good that they don't stop breathing, but when they're like out of it like that, they, you know, walk into traffic or fall off of things, which is not good. So kids, don't take drugs. It's not good for you. Then there's midazolam or Versed, which is a very short-acting benzodiazepine, but it has this wonderful property that it has antrograde amnesia. So antrograde amnesia means that once the drug reaches a therapeutic level in your bloodstream, which when you give it IV is almost immediate, your brain stops laying down memory. So the patient, when you're working with a patient, they're going to seem to be awake. They're usually kind of calm because it is a benzo, but they will not remember anything that transpires between you. So you can't give patients after surgery. Like, giving patients instructions after surgery is like kind of iffy if they had midazolam, because they won't remember. And if you know, I think a way to compare it is if you've ever driven like the same way every day to work or to school or whatever, and sometimes you find that you got in the car and then like suddenly you're at school and you're like, well, I got there. I just don't remember the trip. It's the same idea. Your brain is like, we've done this so many times, I'm not going to bother recording it. And so you don't have that memory. So that's very useful, because if a patient can be awake, they can tell you what's going on, they can you can converse with them, and if you don't have to paralyze them and give them general anesthesia, that's going to be helpful too. So you're going to see midazolam used a lot in what's called twilight sedation, or MAC, I've seen people call it that, and that's for conscious sedation, where you give that in combination with a pain drug, like fentanyl, which is an opiate. And then our friend propofol. So propofol, I mentioned, is very fast acting. Famous for killing what celebrity?
Michael
Jackson. That was definitely not practice, because there's no reason to have propofol in your house. That's ridiculous. But you might see it in ICUs, because it's also used for medical comas. You know, when you put somebody in a coma because they had some kind of head injury or something. So, you know, somebody gotten shot in the head, there's a lot of swelling of the brain. You sometimes will put them in a medical coma. I think that's about all I want to say about anesthesia. Just for you guys, again, it's a big topic, but I'm trying to keep it simple. Do you have a question, or you're just enjoying things? Okay, I'm just having such a fun time. Okay, all right, so that's the end of the drugs that inhibit stuff. Right, so drugs that make you sleepy and reduce your anxiety and stop seizures and put you to sleep or whatever, those were all those. Now we're going to talk about activating drugs. Yes, ma'am.
You said the isoflurane, is that also a muscle relaxant?
No, in fact, I should have mentioned, the halogenated hydrocarbons, nobody really knows how they work. The theory is that it has something to do with GABA, but again, I think the first one was sort of found by accident and then...
So what is that used for, the isoflurane?
It's, you know, in surgery, it's meant to keep you asleep. It keeps you asleep. Unconscious. Because, if you're going to go in and have a 12-hour surgical procedure, you don't want to remember that. That's not going to be fun. Okay, I'm going to say something very briefly about amphetamines. The amphetamines were originally developed by the military. The military developed these to try to keep their soldiers awake during the war, because if they fell asleep when they were in the trenches, then somebody would come up and shoot them, so they needed to keep people awake. The amphetamines after World War II were actually available over the counter, and a lot of people used it as a diet aid. Unfortunately, it was made prescription only in 1965, which is unfortunate for me, because I was born in 1964. My mother has told me she took diet pills the entire time she was pregnant with me, and that did lead to some skeletal problems. I think that's what some of the problems I have are related to that. So now you can't get it legally without prescription. So one of the indications of amphetamines is too much sleepiness, like narcolepsy. Narcolepsy is a disorder where a patient falls asleep at inappropriate times. So you can imagine that would be incredibly disruptive to your day. Turns out, I mentioned it's used as a diet pill, it's because it inhibits your appetite tremendously. Amphetamines are quite good for that. I just saw, I think 2 years ago, a new drug came out called Qsymia, which is a combination of an amphetamine and a anti-seizure drug called Togomax, which has the side effect of making people lose weight. Topamax actually makes people sleepy, so I think the idea was you combine Topamax with this amphetamine, then you don't get sleepy and you just lose weight. So weight loss is another indication for amphetamines. And then also ADD, ADHD. I'm old enough to remember that when people started prescribing drugs for ADHD, there was a huge outcry in the media saying, this is an invented disease, and it's just made up, and it's just a way for doctors and pharmaceutical companies to get rich off of our children. So there was a lot of, I guess that was sort of, you can see my bias about this topic. So it turns out, if you take a patient with ADHD, and you take a patient who does not have ADHD, and you put them both in something that can measure the activity in the brain, there's all sorts of ways to do that nowadays, and you give both of those patients a task that has a few steps, like you say, write your name, you know, hold a ball, fold a piece of paper, you know, you give them a little list of things to do. In the normal brain, in all the normal brains, the brain lights up in a very specific pattern. So if you say write your name, there's parts of your brain that light up to help you write. The language into writing is up in a special part of your brain. And each part of the brain lights up in a very specific order. And you give that same set of directions to an ADHD patient, and their brain just lights up like this. So they have trouble focusing and staying on, sort of on target. If you give that same patient an amphetamine, like Adderall or Ritalin, their brain normalizes. So there's functional evidence that it is a real thing. It's not a pretend thing. I've had quite a lot of students with ADHD, and I can always tell when they didn't take their medication, because it's definitely a real disorder. A lot of the mental illnesses have a stigma that, oh, it's not really a problem, it's just laziness or whatever. But that's definitely a real condition. Unfortunately, a lot of the ADHD students sell their medications because there's a big black market for those things, and so they walk around all confused because they sold their medications for money. So there's no, so far all the evidence is that amphetamines do not improve your academic performance. They will keep you awake, but they don't improve your ability to take a test. So the best way to study for a test is the same old boring way, which is a little bit every day, and make sure you get plenty of sleep. So it's never easy. You can't take a pill for anything. It's really unfair. Okay, so that's my quickie comment about amphetamines. Caffeine, I actually have a video about caffeine on the outside videos for students list, if you're interested in it. It's thought to act by blocking adenosine receptors in what part of your brain that keeps you awake? The RAS, right? Reticular formation, reticular activating system. If it directly blocks adenosine receptors and wakes you up, what is the action of adenosine in the reticular activating system? Yes, it makes you sleepy. So adenosine normally makes you sleepy. So by blocking that, you are more awake. So yay! So inhibiting an inhibitor, once again, saves the day. Caffeine has a lot of different actions on your body, and we'll talk about that a little bit when we talk about the lung drugs for other reasons. One of the things, though, it does is to suppress a hormone called ADH, so that's antidiuretic hormone. You may have learned it as AVP or vasopressin. It's had a lot of names over time. But antidiuretic hormone, I like that name because it tells you what it does. It keeps you from peeing. So if you inhibit the thing that keeps you from urinating, you urinate. So inhibit an inhibitor. Yes? Right? Okay. All right, so that's just a very brief, very, very brief mention of amphetamines. Now, the next page is the DSM-5, which is a new version of the DSM, talking about these three different disorders, depression, mania, and schizophrenia. For me, you do not have to memorize all the criteria, but you do have to be able to recognize a patient. And I won't make it tricky. I mean, it should be pretty clear. If I give you a patient, he or she has these symptoms, what drug do you use? I want you to be able to recognize this, these are very broad definitions. I also give you this to show you, this is how insurance companies determine if a patient is eligible for coverage for these conditions. And what they did, you have to have for depression, you have to have 5 of the following symptoms over a 2-week period every single day, right? And you have to rule out other things. So if a patient is given a diagnosis of depression, it goes to the insurance company, they have somebody who just checks through the record to be sure that you had the 5 things. Now, that is also the way that you diagnose depression. Now, I want you to notice here, like for depression, the things that you have, again, it has to be every day for 2 weeks, Depressed mood or irritability. In teenagers, they're always irritable, so for parents with teenagers with depression, it can be very difficult for them to realize that it's depression, because they're just being teenagers. Sometimes that's what it looks like. Something called anhedonia, which means that things that used to be fun are no longer fun. Nothing is fun. Significant weight loss or weight gain. Some people stop eating when they're depressed, some people eat more when they're depressed. So a significant change of weight. Sleep is screwed up. Either they're sleeping all the time or they can't sleep at all. Again, sleep is very closely tied with other CNS conditions. Second order agitation or retardation, which means agitation is they're pacing around all the time. Retardation is they're just like. Feelings of worthlessness or excessive or inappropriate guilt. Inappropriate guilt's my favorite one. That's one I get all the time. But people who are like constantly saying they're sorry and they're just always, they think everything's their fault. Diminished ability to think or concentrate, so that's cognitive disability. That was my big problem when I got it after my son was born. I couldn't understand what people were telling me, I couldn't read, it was really horrible. And then recurrent thoughts of death. I went through this because I want to show you that to have the diagnosis of even severe depression doesn't mean you have to have suicidal ideation. It can be other things. And in fact, I think in the 80s or 90s, somebody figured out that like a third of the people in nursing homes for dementia were just depressed, and if you treated their depression, they were better. So in those old folks were not suicidal, they just couldn't think and they were confused, and it was because of depression. Now mania is sort of the opposite of this, where instead of having inappropriate guilt, you have inappropriate thoughts that you are fantastic and that everything's going to be great and you will have no negative consequences for anything. People who have depression are at risk of suicide. It is a commonly fatal condition, especially among young people. Mania, it only takes an hour to completely screw up your life. I had a good friend who had a bipolar condition, and over the course of an hour, he completely screwed up his life. And the thing is they do something like, where they think there's no consequence. So they take drugs, they have sex with the football team, they buy all their friends' cars, they charge up all their credit cards, they just don't have that sort of worry about the future. So that's quite a serious thing if it's bad. And then schizophrenia. Schizophrenia there's a lot of misunderstanding about schizophrenia in the general public. First of all, schizophrenia has nothing to do with having multiple personalities. That's a totally different thing. There was a movie in the 70s called Sybil, and for whatever reason, people locked onto this idea that schizophrenia is multiple personality. It is a totally different thing. But schizophrenia is a form of psychosis. It's generally genetic, and it's incredibly common. 1 out of 100 people have it. And if 1 out of 100 Americans have it, that means there's like 30 or 40 million people walking around with some degree of schizophrenia. And they go through a lot of misery because there's also a misconception that all schizophrenics are just on the verge of shooting up a movie theater or something. It's extremely uncommon for schizophrenics to be violent. Usually violence in schizophrenia is increased if they're also using illegal drugs. But a lot of times when you hear about a mass murder, it's a schizophrenic that did it, but that person is 1 out of millions. So schizophrenics have this problem with the stigma of the condition. It has to do with reality testing. So when you're dreaming, the part of your brain that does reality testing is turned off. So it's perfectly reasonable during a dream that you can fly and you're hanging out with Elvis and you're, you know, able to lift trees or whatever, because your brain is just sort of free form thought. When you're awake, there's something called reality testing, which is constantly looking to see if what your brain thinks it's seeing is what your eyes and ears are seeing and hearing. And these patients don't have that. So the problem that when you have a patient with severe schizophrenia, they might be seeing something that you cannot see, but they see it as clearly as you could. So in other words, if they're looking around and everything's on fire, they're like, it's on fire, I smell the smoke, it's definitely on fire, and they're like, oh, we gotta get out of here. Everyone's also like, well, why? Because clearly there's a fire. How can you not see the fire? So that's very difficult, you can imagine, for schizophrenics. Also, if they have voices talking, talking in their head, not just sort of your own ego or superego just thinking, well, I probably shouldn't do that. It's actually voices either talking to them or voices talking to each other. So again, you don't have to have all those symptoms, but you can have some of them, which is problematic. All right, let me talk a little bit about depression. And then I'm gonna show you a couple of videos. We'll take a really quick break and then we'll come back. All right, so we're talking about depression first. The theory behind depression is that there's something called the monoamine hypothesis. The idea being that depression is due to too little norepinephrine and serotonin. All right, so there's depression. So the idea is they have too little norepinephrine and serotonin. Serotonin is always abbreviated as 5-HT for 5-hydroxytryptamine. It's like a very annoying abbreviation. It should be like SER or something, right? But that's what it is. So the drugs that increase serotonin and or norepinephrine seem to be useful for depression. Now, before the 80s or so, there only were a couple drugs or drug classes that were available for depression, or shock therapy. Shock therapy is quite effective, but there's the risk of anesthesia. The idea of shock therapy is that you electrocute the brain so that sort of all the nerves in your body just sort of squirt out their neurotransmitters all at once, and it kind of resets your brain. It's like turning your computer on and off again. But the drugs that were available, like the MAOIs, tricyclic antidepressants, and even lithium, were not, they all had side effects, they all have low therapeutic index. So a lot of people were walking around with untreated depression before the development of Prozac and the SSRI. So we're gonna first talk about some of these older drugs, and then we'll go to the SSRIs. Now, one thing to know is that all the currently approved treatments for depression take 3 to 4 weeks to start working. So if you're talking to a patient and you've decided they have depression, you have to say, okay, now take this drug, you have to take it every day. If there's a problem, you call, and you probably won't get an improvement in your mood for 3 weeks. You gotta just kind of hang on. So what if you have a patient who comes in and they say, I'm gonna kill myself? What do you do? Right, so the first thing you ask is, do you have a plan? That's because patients who are suicidal, who have a plan of how they're going to kill themselves, are at far higher risk of actually carrying through with the suicide. You know, I've always thought of suicide and depression as just being like a, it's just like you can die from cancer, you can die from diabetes, you can die from suicide. It's really a hormonal, neurotransmitter-based thing. And people have noticed over time that if the patient has a plan, they have a much higher chance of committing suicide. So then what do? So you're not in your office, you're at Panera Bread. And your friend comes up and they say, you know, how are you doing? I'm gonna kill myself. I have a gun, or I'm gonna go jump off a cliff. Then what do? Well, you could monitor them, you could sit at their side until the feeling passes, which might not pass. Usually, from everything I've read, my own experiences is that the urge to actually commit suicide is fairly short-lived, and the patient will sort of cycle out of it, and they'll be okay. So one thing you could do is just sit by their side. And if it was the zombie apocalypse, that's definitely what you would do. What do you do if it's not the zombie apocalypse? That's sort of an open-ended question. I should put that on the desk. What do you do if it's the zombie apocalypse? Well, what do you, I mean, a person is at high risk of suicide. Where should they be? They should be in the emergency room. So emergency rooms all have psychiatrists that are on call specifically to deal with that. So if somebody calls you and says, I'm suicidal, then get out a different phone or have somebody else call 911 and get an ambulance to them, or take them to the emergency room. Or if you're in an office and there's a psychiatrist in the building, take them to see the psychiatrist, whatever it takes. You need that person to be evaluated for risk. And if they're at risk, they get admitted to the hospital provided that there's a bed. Now the problem with most psychiatric floors in hospitals is that the beds are always full. It's hard to get patients in. Because if it takes 3 weeks for the drug to start working and they're suicidal, you have to keep them in the hospital for 3 weeks at least, because you can't let them just leave if they're still suicidally depressed. There's some research right now looking at ketamine, that anesthetic, because some people have reported anecdotally that ketamine seems to help lift depression very quickly, and that would be fantastic if we could have a situation where a person who's suicidal, you could get them out in something less than 3 weeks. If the first drug you try doesn't work in 3 weeks, then you have to try another drug, and then that's another 3 weeks. So the hospitalizations take a long time. So that's what you do. You ask if there's a plan, and depending on your concern for the person, you get them to the emergency room for an evaluation, okay? That's what you need to do. Probably best off to always just have them evaluated in case you don't really know. But that's just so you know. Because it happens, I mean, it's happened to me a couple of times where I've been in a situation where somebody says they're suicidal and I'm not at work or anything, it's just like a person I know. It's good to know what to do. All right, so let's talk about some of these drugs for depression. Again, these drugs increase norepinephrine and or serotonin. The first one is monoamine oxidase inhibitors. So monoamine oxidase inhibitors, what is their mechanism of action? They inhibit monoamine oxidase, which breaks down norepinephrine. So it actually breaks down norepinephrine and serotonin. And so some of them actually also break down dopamine, which is a whole other thing. So these are drugs that inhibit that enzyme. Now they inhibit the enzyme that breaks down norepinephrine irreversibly. So what was the drug class that irreversibly inhibited acetylcholinesterase? It was a poison.
Was it organ?
Right, so sarin gas, organophosphates, pesticides. And in that case, you know, acetylcholine's all over your whole body. So if you irreversibly screw up acetylcholinesterase, you die. You can irreversibly block monoamine oxidase and not die. And if you're depressed, it might cheer you up too. All neurotransmitters are not created equally. The problem with monoamine oxidase inhibitors being irreversible is that once you give a patient a monoamine oxidase inhibitor, you've screwed up their monoamine oxidase for their whole body until their body can make new monoamine oxidase, which takes about 2 weeks. Okay? So it's irreversible, it blocks monoamine oxidase, and that's, you have to wait 2 weeks for you to get that again. Okay? So far so good. What drug class what specific drug class can you not mix with monoamine oxidase inhibitors? It was on the first test. And it shall be on further tests. Yeah? It had to be on non drug because those are the only ones that were on the first test. Well, be brave. If you're wrong, it's fine. Just guess. What? Something to do with the autonomic nervous system. Oh. What's the question? So, what drug class can you not take with monoamine oxidase inhibitor?
Alpha
1 agonist. Sorry. Okay. I apologize, I just thought I was being clear. Okay, so that's because alpha-1 agonists are stimulating those norepinephrine receptors, right? And this drug allows a buildup of norepinephrine because it inhibits the enzyme. So you don't want to mix monoamine oxidase inhibitors with anything that is going to stimulate the sympathetic nervous system. And it's so important that if you have somebody who's on a monoamine oxidase inhibitor and they go take phenylephrine or something, they can give themselves a stroke because they get incredible vasoconstriction and the blood pressure just shoots through the roof. And it's like something that happens. That's not like a really rare thing. So they have to be very careful about what drug they're taking. There's a molecule in food called tyramine, which also stimulates norepinephrine receptors, it's indirect acting. And so you have dietary restrictions with MAOIs. And I think of it as the fondue diet. I was on an MAOI for about 2 months once, because other things weren't working. And the food you couldn't have was fondue restaurant food. So you couldn't have cheese, you couldn't have wine, and you can't have chocolate, which is like the worst. So there's a whole list of foods, but I think of the fondue restaurant as the best way, the name of it. So with the MAOIs, there's all this dietary restriction where if somebody eats really good dark chocolate, they might give themselves a stroke, which is so tragic. I can't even believe it. The other thing is, you can't have the MAOI molecule in the bloodstream at the same time as any antidepressant. Why would that be? What do antidepressants do? Trying to give you a hint. How does an antidepressant cheer you up?
They increase
norepinephrine. So you can't, any antidepressants, you can't mix it with an MAOI. So that means if you have a patient who is depressed and nothing is working and you want to try MAOIs, and there's plenty of people on MAOIs, what you have to do is stop all their antidepressants, wait until that clears from their bloodstream, which takes about 2 weeks, then you start the MAOI, then you wait a month or two to see if it works, and if it doesn't work, you have to stop the MAOI, wait for your body to make more enzyme, and then start a new antidepressant. So you can see why it's not the first choice for people, because it's got a lot of problems. But if 10% of the population gets depressed, you figure some portion of that are all gonna get medicated because it's severe enough to affect them, which means that if 1% of the population doesn't respond to the other antidepressants, that's still millions of people who are gonna be taking MAOIs. So once you know about MAOIs, you'll start hearing it in drug commercials. You'll hear at the end of drug commercials, you'll say, ask your doctor if you take an MAOI. That's because that drug probably can't be taken with an MAOI. Okay, so that two-week window, that's only for MAOIs. None of the other antidepressants have that problem. You're gonna take them all at the same time if you need to, but I wouldn't advise. Okay, the next older class of drugs is the tricyclic or tetracyclic or cyclic antidepressants. It's from literature, it looks like people are still kind of calling them TCAs or cyclics. This is a class of drugs that people don't really know exactly how it works. It has lots of effects on a lot of different kinds of neurotransmitters. It's thought that it blocks reuptake. What was the other drug that blocks reuptake that was on the quiz last week? It's an illegal
Cocaine.
Cocaine is actually used by ENT to numb up the inside of your sinuses when they're operating on your sinuses. Ophthalmologists, we sometimes have a test where we put a drop of cocaine on someone's eye to see how it dilates. But otherwise, it's illegal to be used in medicine as well. Okay, so the tricyclic antidepressants have a low therapeutic index, and that means what? If a drug has a low therapeutic index, what does that mean to you? Yeah. Right. You can. It doesn't take a huge dose to be toxic and/or fatal. So if you have a patient who's suicidal, and if you're going to put them on TCAs, don't give them the 6 month supply, right? Because that's something that they can kill themselves with. You want to be careful about that. The TCAs also have what are called anticholinergic side effects. Okay. So now I have to tell you something I didn't want to tell you before. But in medicine, when you hear somebody refer to a drug that has anticholinergic side effects, it might not mean that the drug actually binds a cholinergic receptor. Usually that shorthand, an anticholinergic side effects, means that the side effects include, now what would be anticholinergic side effects? Dry mouth, right? What else? Constipation? What else? What about pupils?
Constriction.
Nope. Dilate. And you gotta be careful about dilated pupils with what problem?
Glaucoma.
Some types of glaucoma. What else? What about the old guys with the big prostates? It's gonna make it, you're gonna reduce urine flow. So sort of this constellation of side effects, dry mouth, constipation, reduced urine flow, glaucoma, glaucoma, there's a shorthand that says anticholinergic side effects. You're supposed to know what that is. That's just a general healthcare thing. For me, I'm gonna try to keep it where anticholinergic means it binds the cholinergic receptor, but I just need to let you know about that because as you get more and more closer to your goal, you're gonna see that term used by the general healthcare people. Okay, the problem in terms of its toxicity is that it's not good for your heart and liver. TCAs, again, one of these drugs that's found by accident to work for a bunch of stuff. It's taken by a lot of people for pain. So for chronic pain, for migraine, I take nortriptyline for migraine. I have a girlfriend who is a musician and gets TMJ, and I know that for a while she's taking amitriptyline for pain. So nortriptyline isn't always taken for depression. It also can be used for enuresis. What was that? Do you guys remember what that meant? Enuresis. So ureus sounds like something to do with pee. That would be aneuresis is no urine. A-N. Hmm? It's sort of the code word for bedwetting. So, and you know, people who urinate while they're asleep, that's not just little kids. A lot of people have it. Okay, so those are sort of the worst of them. So let's talk about the SSRIs. SSRIs, the first one I believe was Prozac, and because these other drugs are so horrible to deal with, there were a lot of people walking around with depression that was untreated. And when Prozac came out, and it seemed to have a good safety profile, and it didn't have all these weird restrictions, all the patients who previously hadn't gotten any treatment now got treatment. And as a medical student, I remember we called it vitamin P, because it seemed like every patient was on Prozac. Every patient was not on Prozac. It's just that people were getting to try an antidepressant for the first time. And so that was. Now, when that happened, of course, there was a huge media outcry. We're over-medicating people. There's no reason for people to have this. Tom Cruise says depression isn't even a real thing. You should just exercise. There was all this sort of hubbub. But depression's a real thing. Prozac definitely works. And for 30% of patients with depression, when they try Prozac or an SSRI, it works. So SSRIs, are they direct acting or indirect acting?
Indirect
acting. Indirect acting, they increase serotonin. If you take too much of them, you can develop something called serotonin syndrome, which weirdly, evidently, I've never seen it, but weirdly, it can resemble malignant hyperthermia, which makes no sense because, right? But if you try to use dantrolene, it won't help. It's just due to too much serotonin. It can be confusion, things like that. So, serotonin, right? You have an SSRI. It is indirect acting and therefore increases the level of the neurotransmitter, which in this case is?
Serotonin.
So if you have an overdose of serotonin, what can you use to treat the overdose?
A direct acting
antagonist, okay? So it's the same idea. So you can see, hopefully, how I could ask you a question about this to make sure you still know it, right? Because what I'm looking for is indirect drugs change the neurotransmitter level, and that the antidote, poison-antidote combination is usually due to competition for a receptor, okay? Just want to make sure you have that. Okay. There's also atypical antidepressants. They're atypical in that they're newer. For some reason, they're not called second or third generation. They're just called atypical. That's just something weird that happened. These are newer ones. Bupropion is one of these atypical antidepressants. And what's nice about bupropion is that it does not decrease your libido or sex drive. And I have a friend who's a psychiatrist. He told me that he's only ever gotten gifts from people's partners when he puts a patient on Wellbutrin because it helps their sex life. Weirdly, bupropion is also used for people who are trying to quit smoking. It's under a different trade name, but it's the same drug. Why it works for that was found by accident, but it's all good, right? There's SSNRIs, SSNRI is a selective serotonin and norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. So this increases serotonin and norepinephrine. The first one that came out that was like very successful was Effexor. And then a newer one is Cymbalta, which I think has overtaken Effexor in terms of people prescribing it. The SSNRIs are famous and hated by patients because they have terrible withdrawal symptoms. The SSRIs also have some withdrawal symptoms, so you gotta be, you know, you taper them off when you're stopping the drug. But the SSNRIs are famous, so you can find all over the internet, you can find people trying to sign petitions getting FDA to stop making Effexor because the withdrawal is so terrible. But if the withdrawal is bad, you just taper it. That's how you do it. There's a new class of drugs, the SARIs, which are serotonin 2R. So serotonin 2R, that's a subtype of the receptor. Blockers and reuptake inhibitors that are newer drugs. Actually, trazodone is an older drug. Just so you know that that's around. But again, as always, the bold face is what I'm looking for. Hopefully you'll notice that some of the endings are the same. So here's a zetine and a zetine. Pram is one, and then faxing is one as well. So just to help you sort of, don't have to memorize everyone, just have an idea of it, okay? Everybody okay so far? Sort of going through this fast, okay. Now, if you have a patient who just has plain old depression, and you give them lots and lots of antidepressants, you will not make them high or manic, because antidepressants do not make you high. The proof of which is that there's no black market for antidepressants. They just make you normal. They don't make you high. So in the same way that aspirin, if you have a fever and you take an aspirin or a Tylenol or whatever, your fever comes down, right? But if you don't have a fever and you take Tylenol, your temperature doesn't drop more. So the Tylenol and the aspirin, what they're doing is just making your temperature normal. And the same thing with the antidepressants. They do not make you high, they just make you normal. Okay, more like yourself. Now, if you have bipolar disorder, and maybe it's not even diagnosed, and you're depressed, and you go and somebody gives you an antidepressant, there's a good chance that you will then flip into mania. So you don't want to give manic patients antidepressants unless you really know what you're doing, because you could easily flip them into mania. So that's a concern that if a patient is depressed, you want to be sure that they're depressed and not manic. A lot of the bipolar patients, they cycle. Van Gogh was famous because he would cycle in a very specific way through the year. And so when he was manic, he painted a ton of stuff, and when he was depressed, he painted nothing. And so people have tracked when he painted, and all his paintings were, I think, in February and August or something, the rest of the year he didn't paint very much. Whereas other people who are bipolar might cycle through one day, be cycling depressed, manic. That's that. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to show you a video, which are both online, so if you need to take a break or go pee or whatever, you can do that. I'm just going to show you a video of Charlie Sheen as an example of a bad mania, and another guy from the 70s who had very bad psychosis, because I want you to see the difference between them. So if you need to take a break, this is the time to go. All right, so I'm going to start with Charlie Sheen. This was a fairly famous interview. The woman who's interviewing him, I recognize her face, but I don't know who she is. She is trying to get him to say, she's trying to prove that his weird behavior is due to drugs. But taking drugs doesn't help, but he's classic manic. So I just want you to sort of get out. I won't show you the whole thing, I'm just going to show you parts of it. All right, so let's.
Household items. When was the last time I ingested or took drugs?
Yes, when
was
the last time you took drugs?
Such an AA, stupid expression or term. I don't remember. I do not remember.
A week ago, 2 weeks ago,
a month
2 days
ago,
ago.
6 weeks. I don't know. It was a couple days before the suits rolled in and said, change it, change everything, we're shutting you down.
Tell me about the last time you took drugs.
The last time I took drugs, I probably took more than anybody could survive, you know?
What are we talking about? How much?
I don't know, man. I was banging 7 gram rocks and finishing them because that's how I roll. I have one speed, I have one gear. Go.
How do you survive that?
Because I'm me. I'm different. I just have a different constitution. I have a different brain. I have a different heart. I have a different, I get tiger blood, man.
You don't worry that you're going to die when you take that many drugs?
Dying's for fools.
But you're only human.
Now, there's certain legs I will not entertain because that's how people go down. I'm too smart to do that. So you know, I'm sorry for the guys that that happened to, but, you know, you should have read the directions before you showed up at the party, you know?
So you have, actually have a strategy about how you take your drugs?
No, I just have a couple of rules. I don't know if it's a strategy.
You're clean right now.
Sure.
And so is this better now? Your life now, clean
it's,
with your children.
Yeah,
is
no,
it better
perfect.
Than
it's
me?
Not.
So that, you know, so you see that he's like, oh, I can take tons of, I think he was talking about some sort of speed or amphetamine or something or cocaine or I don't know. And he's saying, well, the reason I can take huge amounts is because I'm special. I have a special physiology. Other people can't survive. Now, the truth of it is, if he's actually doing that, is he's probably built up tolerance. People have built up tremendous tolerance to some drugs where they're taking ridiculous doses that would kill anyone else because their body is so revved up and ready to break down that drug. Yes, it's because I'm me. Dying is for fools. He has no concern that he's going to die, clearly. He says, I'm too smart for that. So he's doing things that are clearly not good for him. And if he didn't have a huge cadre of support people keeping him going because they need him for a TV show, he would be in a terrible spot. So that's mania. And the reason I want to show this is because under mania, there's something that says they have pressure of speech. Like when he was talking, it was sort of like all one sentence. And there's lots of us that talk fast. I know I'm one of them. But that's sort of just go. And here's a patient from the 70s. And I'm just going to show you 3 minutes of this. Now, we assume that Charlie Sheen in that video is under medication. So you can imagine how bad his condition is if that's how he is when he's medicated. Similarly, this is a patient who has very severe schizophrenia. And at the beginning of the video, they say he's on Haldol, which is a type of antipsychotic. So he's a very severe case. All right. And this is from the 70s, so everyone has, you know, everyone's outfit is very weird.
He's currently on the following medications: haloperidol, 32 milligrams daily; benztropine B, 4 milligrams daily.
I do it a lot. I think and feel as though people have called me here to electrocute me, judge me, put me in jail, or kill me, electrocute me because of some of the sins I've been in. Is this a new deal for you? The main thing is don't get excited, but the thing is it's not a new feeling, no. I'm scared of you.
Must be very frightening for you, then. Do you
so
like your back
and
it kills?
I'm so scared, I can tell you that picture's got a headache.
Can you tell me more about that? The picture has a headache? Do
you? You want to know?
Yes, I do.
Okay, when a sperm and an egg go together to make a baby, only one sperm goes up in that egg. And when they touch, there's two contact points that touch before the other two. And then it's carried up into the air. And when they fuse, it's like nuclear fusion, except a tumor fusion. There's a mass loss of the proton. One heat abstraction goes up in the electron, it spins around, comes back down into the proton to form the mind, and the mind can be reduced to one atom.
Jerry, in one patient at one time, shows almost every one of the major features of schizophrenia. His thinking is disorganized, the thoughts are loosely connected, he has formed delusional ideas. Some of those delusions are grandiose, some of them are paranoid. He has disturbances in his mood. His mood is, in some cases, almost absent, and in other cases, is totally inappropriate. And his behavior is disordered. It's unusual. He has mannerisms that are inexplicable. He has purposeless, aimless behavior around the ward. He's a textbook case. He combines all those things in one person.
At this point, what would you like us to do for you?
I'd like you to get me off of cigarettes. Get me dried out, cleaned up, so I can go home and get a job in the bakery and go to medical school.
Jerry's voices may at times say, you raped that woman. In a case where he may have just seen a woman on the street, the voices will accuse him of assaulting her. One of the things that worries me about Jerry and about many patients is at times his voices tell him to do things. In just the short time he's been in this program, the voices at times have told him that he's got to leave because we're going to hurt him. So obviously they say things that greatly distress him, that scare him.
Nice to see you.
Dr. Bigelow, please.
So you see that what's called almost word salad, or where he has one sentence and there's like different concepts in the same sentence that don't all go together. And this is, obviously he's a very severe case. But I just think it's good to see that, because we're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back and I'm going to tell you about a few drugs for mania, and then we'll talk about antipsychotics. They have terrible side effects, and you might say, why would anyone take these drugs? And it's because patients with schizophrenia can really be suffering. Because clearly, if you want to, you can watch, there's actually, I think, a 2 or 3 part video here, and you see that he can't take care of himself. So That's the stakes. All right, let's take like a 2 or 3 minute break, just like a little quick break, get up and get some oxygen or something to eat, and we'll come back and get back on it.
Did you have to go on an exam last time?
Yeah. Wait, there you go. So here's your stuff, Cheryl, right? So here's this.
Did you give them?
No, I need the test back. But anytime you want, you can just let me know and I'll bring in the test. You can take a look at it. I always have the key with me, so that way you can always take one. And you guys are not getting up and taking a break. I just watched a video by this guy, Thomas Frank, who his YouTube channel is on evidence-based study habits. And his most recent video, he talks about how to get the most information to stick in your brain, you have to take scheduled breaks. And during scheduled breaks, you can't be doing something else that's goal-directed. You need to like go take a walk or go to something to eat and not just be like, look at Facebook and stuff like that. Because your brain needs a break. And then when you come back, you can be focused again. And if you're doing a long time, like you're studying for a test, you schedule breaks. Okay, I'm gonna study whatever, and then at 10 o'clock, I'm gonna take a break. And then go for a walk, go do something that's completely unrelated for 10 or 15 minutes, and then come back. So I noticed that students who get up and walk out tend to be more alert for the second half of class than the ones who don't. So I used to make everyone get up and do stretching. Maybe I should start that again. People were like, I'm uncomfortable, I don't want to stretch. I guess the light's out there. Lights are off. Everyone's sleepy. You know what? I have a key to that test if you'd like to look at the answers to the essay stuff. Is this it? Yeah. So if you want to look, because there's going to be questions that were on this test that are going to be quite similar, like the pharmacokinetic stuff, the dog lab thing, the explaining agonist versus antagonist and competitive inhibition. There's going to be some questions like that on the next test, so make sure you got it down. I'd ask you not to take photos of it, but you definitely can take notes. You know what I mean? I mean, I try to change the test every semester, but there are some things that some questions I want to watch. All right. Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Oh, God. Should I turn off the light by the screen? I don't want to make everyone in the front sort of fall asleep, but should I turn off the light? You're okay with that? Okay. I don't want anyone to have eye strain, but on the other hand, I remember I talked close one summer, and there was a guy that sat right in the front row with his arms folded like this. And every time I turned on the light, he was out. Like, he just closed his eyes.
So just know that I wish I could fall asleep. I can't fall asleep. But even in like 7 hours, if I can, it's like 10 minutes.
Yeah. Well, too young. Once you're old, you can have a nap like that. I can pretty much lie down and just sleep. It's
When you're old, you just nap constantly, sleep very little. So. Which reminds me, I should say, oh, so here's a question. Do you remember, it was a couple weeks ago, where I came in and I said I'd been started on an amphetamine? I told you guys about that.
Yes.
By the way, I don't want you to think that I'm trying to burden you with my sob story. It's just that I'm a patient and I feel like I can help you guys with my own experience. It's not because I am trying to like unload things on you. So I just want you to know that. So anyway, so my depression has been really bad the last couple of months. So I went in to see my doctor about 3 weeks ago, two, 3 weeks ago, and he said, let's try an amphetamine. So we started on a drug that's like an amphetamine. It's a different molecule. It basically works the same way. Now, why would an amphetamine boost a patient with depression? No, maybe I'm taking too much amphetamine. Dancing around. Yeah. Because what? Energy. Energy definitely keeps you awake. The sleepiness is gone. Yeah.
Yes.
Right? Because amphetamines increase norepinephrine, serotonin, dopamine, right? So by increasing norepinephrine, you get that boost, and then, you know, now what's weird about it is very activating, so it does wake you up. Even though it has a long half-life, I find that I get a benefit for about 6-7 hours, and then I'm exhausted, and then I just have to sleep, and I'm depressed at night. And then I wake up, I take the pill, I'm good during the day, depressed at night. So, patients who take amphetamines long-term, I'm hoping I won't be on it long-term because my blood pressure is like crazy high now. The patients who take it long-term, or people that abuse amphetamines, as I mentioned, they take higher and higher and higher doses. And when they don't, and then if they suddenly stop taking the medication, they like can't stay awake, right? They can't, you know, they can't think, they can't stay awake. Why would it be that when they take away the amphetamine suddenly, they can't stay awake? Shouldn't they just be back to what they were before they started the amphetamine?
No, because now the body's used to that amphetamine.
What were you saying?
I was going to say because the drug doesn't, it would inhibit the reuptake of amphetamine, which would deplete your natural supply of amphetamine. So when they take it away, your body has to reproduce it, which takes a while.
That is an excellent argument and it's very logical, which, and it probably is a factor. I think that's great. But the way I'm thinking about it is that, as I mentioned with the reflex tachycardia, reflex bradycardia, whenever you're giving a patient a drug, your body kind of tries to fight it because your body is trying to maintain homeostasis. So when you give a drug that's activating your brain, the way your brain responds to that is to increase activity in the inhibitory nerves, right? Remember, there was hyperpolarizing nerves and there's excitatory nerves, the depolarizing nerves. So if you give a drug that's depolarizing everything, then the way your brain responds to that is to start hyperpolarizing everything. And if you take the drug away suddenly, now you're left with too much inhibition. So patients who stop taking amphetamines suddenly, they can't stay awake. And like I said, my ADHD students, if they didn't take the medicine that day, I can always tell them they're like barely awake and they can't think about stuff. Now, as opposed to the regular antidepressants, the amphetamines do make people high or stay awake or whatever. And so they have a different mechanism, so they're generally not used for depression because they do have some side effects. But it does work, but only briefly so. But that kind of theory is what I'm looking for on tests, right? So if we know that norepinephrine and serotonin, raising it causes fixes depression and lowering it would fix mania, then if I give you any drug that changes norepinephrine or serotonin, you should be able to predict if that drug could be used for depression or mania. Now, when it does come to mania, most patients with mania have bipolar disease, meaning that they flip between terrible depression and terrible mania, or mild depression, mild mania, depending on the patient. And the drugs that are used for manic patients tend to be mood stabilizers. So they kind of make it so they're not too depressed and they're not too manic. So it tries to keep them in the middle. And it was discovered, again, sort of by accident, that a lot of mania can be treated with some of the anti-seizure drugs. So, where am I? Yes, here we go. Right, so down here I have some of them. Valproic acid, Depakote, Depakine, we talked about before. Carbamazepine or Tegretol, that works also. You can use that for mania. There's another one called Lamictal or Lamotrigine. That's not bold face for you guys, but that's another one that people use for mania. And then the sort of classic drug that people use for mania is lithium. So lithium is number 3 on the periodic table. So it is not metabolized, right? Because it's an ion. It would be like saying, oh, I'm going to metabolize some sodium, right? So it's not metabolized. So the way that it gets out of your body is to be excreted through urine, and it actually uses the same carriers as sodium. So if you guys that are taking AMP now, have you done kidneys yet?
No.
Just starting it? Okay. I have to get a drink of water because of my anticholinergic side. Okay. So the way that your body regulates the amount of water in your body is to regulate the amount of sodium in your body. So in the kidney, there's all these little transport molecules along the nephron that either bring sodium back into the bloodstream or allow it to leave through the urine, and then water always will follow the sodium. So lithium is excreted the same way that sodium is. So if a patient is dehydrated, or let me just ask, if you're dehydrated, is your body going to urinate more or less? Less, right? So when the blood goes through the kidney, all the sodium that's in the urine is going to be taken back into the bloodstream in order to preserve that urine. So if a patient who's taking lithium gets dehydrated, they will stop excreting the lithium as fast as they should be, so they can get toxic. Okay? Does that make sense? So what do you think the treatment for lithium toxicity is?
Water,
hydration, all right? Now, say you have a patient who calls you up, because again, the nurse is the one who has to answer all the questions about drugs in a doctor's office. They call you up and they say, I'm really nauseated, I don't know what it is. And you look at their file and you see that they're on lithium. So it could be that they're toxic on lithium because they're dehydrated, or maybe they took too much lithium, that happens too, okay? Or maybe they're nauseous and vomiting because of the flu, or maybe they ate some bad pig salad or something. You don't know why they're nauseated or vomiting. The great thing is the treatment's the same no matter what, which is, what's the treatment for nausea and vomiting? And dehydration.
Drink
water. Fluids, right? So luckily, the treatment for lithium toxicity and any other kind of dehydration from vomiting is the same, which is that you push fluids. So a patient taking lithium has to have sufficient water intake, and they also have to have sufficient sodium intake. When I was in school, patients having enough sodium intake was never a problem because everybody ate tons of salt and it wasn't a big deal. But in the last 10 years, USDA has come out with guidelines where you're supposed to be eating a lot less salt every day. So if you have a patient who's on lithium and they're like super, you know, careful and hardly have any sodium, you're going to be in trouble because they're going to dehydrate themselves, and you don't want them to lose all their sodium because that will kill you. That's not good. So a patient on lithium, you have to make sure they have enough water and enough salt. What's the saltiest foods? Something that's salty? Any kind of salty food?
Canned foods.
Yeah, anything that's pre-made, because there's a lot of sodium in it that's not in salt, but it's in sodium, which is part of preservatives. Things in brine, like pickles and sauerkraut, have lots of salt. My personal favorite is the cup of noodles ramen that comes in the styrofoam cup. I think it has 1,200 milligrams of sodium in one serving. So whenever I'm feeling dehydrated, that's what I go to. I'm like that. And then I drink tons of water with it. So that's where you want to go to. Things like salt, pretzels and potato chips actually don't have that much salt in them. The salt that's in there is just on the surface. So they don't have as much salt in them. So you always want to go for those ramen. Don't ever give ramen noodles to somebody with heart failure. It's not good. Yeah.
Isn't Gatorade also pretty salty?
Gatorade is not that salty.
I thought it was.
It's supposed to be, but if you actually look at the ingredients, I don't mean to make you guys incredibly suspicious and critical and cynical about everything that you purchase, but always look at the ingredients, because sometimes I get Gatorade because I really want to have some potassium, because almost everybody nobody gets enough potassium. But the Gatorade that you can buy at Jewel or whatever, that's not the kind that has a lot of salt in it.
Yeah.
Pedialyte is supposed to be good. I haven't looked at that recently. Always check the ingredients. That's the thing. Okay. All right. I think that's mostly what I want to say. Now, there are some what are called atypical antipsychotic drugs. Antipsychotic drugs were originally named because they were used for psychosis. The atypical, which are now, which means second, third generation antipsychotics, actually seem to help mania, some mania patients, low doses of it seems to help some depressed patients, which is very odd. And so atypical antipsychotic drugs, that name is misleading. It's used for a lot of stuff. But in this class, it's mostly psychosis, so it works out. Abilify, I see ads for this all the time now. Olanzapine can be used for mania, but I am told by professionals that it's more the anti-seizure drugs that are used for that. Okay. Also, olanzapine can cause diabetes, so that's not so great. Okay, any questions about mania? It's all push to clear. Okay, all right, so antidepressants, you increase norepinephrine or serotonin. They don't make you high. You can't use amphetamines, but they do elevate mood. Mania, you're looking for something that's a mood stabilizer, like a seizure drug or lithium. Yes, any questions? No, you're just stretching. Just having a great time. Okay, that's it. All right, so the antipsychotics. Again, schizophrenia is not multiple personality disorder. It's a disruption of reality testing. There's a lot of neurotransmitters that are involved and implicated. Again, schizophrenia is not the same for every patient, just like depression isn't. There's a lot of different subtypes. There's a lot of evidence that not only dopamine, but serotonin and histamine are important in psychosis. But for this class, and in terms of remembering stuff, I would think of the antipsychotics as anti-dopamine drugs. Right? So direct-acting blockers of dopamine receptors. Now, there's lots of dopamine receptors. Some of them are stimulatory, some of them are inhibitory, but just think about dopamine. And the reason I want you to think about it that way is that a patient with psychosis has too much dopamine. What else, if you have too much dopamine, there's something else that you can have that's a problem? There's actually a couple of them. Too much dopamine. Just too little. High dopamine, if you have high dopamine activity in your brain, Tourette's can be involved, but it's vomiting. And then remember, dopamine can cross-react with beta-1 receptors. So you can also have blood pressure disturbances. So if you give a patient too much dopamine, you can make them psychotic, their blood pressure gets wonky, and they'll be puking all over you. Okay? If you block too much dopamine, you cause symptoms that look like Parkinson's or different movement disorders. And that seems to me very odd, right? The opposites are psychosis, movement disorder. Like, why are those two opposites? Brain is difficult to comprehend. We still haven't figured it out. And dopamine has lots and lots of things that it does for your brain. So if you give a psychotic patient too much, or actually, you just block their dopamine, you give them symptoms that look like Parkinson's. If you have Parkinson's and you give that patient too much dopamine, they can get psychotic, and vomit, and their blood pressure gets wonky. Right? So I think it's easiest to remember the antipsychotics and the Parkinson's drugs as anti-dopamine and dopamine. I think that's the easiest way. When you're first learning them, that's the easiest way to remember them. Now, I'm actually going to show you the side effects first because the side effects are really bad. Side effects are generally lumped as something called EPS, or extrapyramidal symptoms, which are movement problems. The first one is dystonia, which are twitches and spasms. Tonia usually has to do with muscles, dystonia. Akathisia is pacing and restlessness. So, you know, a person, if you go to a psych ward, there's usually one guy kind of walking around a lot. That's akathisia. And Parkinsonism means symptoms that look like Parkinson's. So if you had experience with a patient or somebody in your family or friend who has Parkinson's, you probably recognize a lot of the symptoms of it. So one problem that Parkinson's patients have is they have trouble initiating gait. It's hard to get started, but the part of the brain that will catch them still works. So the way they walk is to fall forward and catch themselves. So they get this gait, which is like this, and that's called a festinating gait. That is a Parkinsonian type thing. Also, they can get what's called, like, a masked what's called a mask-like face. Their face doesn't move. Once you spend a little time with a patient with Parkinson's or a patient on antipsychotics and you experience this talking to somebody whose face doesn't move, you can spot it then from, it's pretty easy to spot people at that point that are on it. A lot of them have a particular tremor. Sometimes they do certain movements with their hands, but otherwise they tend to be frozen. I have a bunch of